Chapter 35, Eric Eazy-E Wright. I briefly met Eric at the Eve After Dark. The first time I saw him, he and Dre came together. I refused him entry because they weren't dressed right. They came back again. This time, Dre was dressed right, but Eazy wasn't. Once again, I refused him entry, but I let Dre in the club. Eventually, he got into the club, and he hung out from time to time. Eazy was about 5'5 and talked the most shit. He made his height, voice, and mannerisms work for him. He was a funny dude. The first time he came to my house, contrary to what you saw straight out of Compton, Eazy was driving a Suzuki Samurai. When he got out of the car, the first thing I noticed was his eye was black as hell and he was holding it. I'm like, what happened to you? Dre said, laughing his ass off. His girl hit him in the head with a G.I. Joe lunch pail. Fucked him up. Eric was a nice guy, but his girl at that time had him on a real short leash. He had to report every move he made. This dude would use my phone and report everything happening at my house on a regular basis. I just got a cordless phone. He walk in the house. Hey, man, let me use your phone, man. All right. Yeah, I'm at Alonzo's house. Yeah, Dre, Yella, Alonzo in the kitchen. Then he'd hang up. When we got ready to leave, he'd call her again. Yeah, we finna leave Alonzo's house. Huh? Oh, we going to Macola. I'm driving my car. Alonzo driving his BMW. Nah, ain't no girls going. It's just the fellas. And then later on, we going to Pink's Hot Dogs. I'm gonna get a chili dog. I'm gonna get a Coke. This shit used to drive me fucking nuts, okay? Everywhere we went, he had to stop and check in. I'm like, man, what the fuck are you doing? Oh, man, I don't want to hear her mouth. She be tripping sometime. Back then, I only had one cordless phone in the house. It got so bad, every time I got to use my phone, I had to ask Eric because he had the motherfucker in his pocket. That shit drove me nuts. I'm like, God damn, man, give me my phone. When I think of some of the things that happened back in the day, I realize I'm the only one that's seen this side of these guys. I have no reason to lie and nothing to hide. It's just my story. Unlike most people, I knew the members of NWA, except for Ren, before they turned into the characters they became and put on their Raider hats. Some people may mistake this for coming off as a hater. Not the case at all. But anybody that knows me, I'm a straight shooter. I keep it 100 all the time. And I say certain things not to hurt anybody's image, it's just to help somebody not be influenced by lyrics and a stage persona. Hopefully a young person will understand that the imagery that was created was more of an act than a true person, like an alter ego. If you've ever been backstage at a play, you see the actors before they put on their makeup. So you see them before they hit the stage, your perception is different from everybody else's. When you're in the audience, you only see the finished product. All you as a consumer know is the finished product. All you care to see is the finished product. But there's various sides to every production. Pre-production, production, post-production. I know pre-production. I live backstage firsthand of the pre-production of the entire West Coast movement. Shit, I was the stage manager for most of it. Eazy and Jerry Heller. When Jerry assisted us in getting the $1,500 each from After, as far as Dre and Yella was concerned, Jerry was a hip-hop god. So the next thing I know, Dre's hyping Jerry to Eazy. Eric wants to meet him. The way Jerry tells it in his book, he met Eric through me, which is true. Where the two stories differ, that Jerry claims he was so impressed with Eazy and his music that he felt that me and my crew, who are established artists, should be a part of Eric's new unproven crew. And if we decided not to join Eric's crew, he wasn't going to deal with us anymore. And there was always a discrepancy about the $750 that I allegedly was paid for him to meet Eazy. We'll get that straightened out too. Here's what really happened. Dre was going to do beats for Eazy in exchange for Eazy bailing him out of jail after I refused to get him out for the third time because he kept getting speeding tickets and letting him go to warrants. Dre used my studio to do Eric's beats. I explained to Dre and to Easy both, Dre went to jail, Lonzo didn't. So when it comes to using my studio, you gotta pay me. Dre programming Easy's beats was on Dre. I let him use my drum machine, my keyboards, but when it comes to pushing record on the recorder, I gotta get paid. Easy racked up about $500 in studio time for his demos. When Easy wanted to meet Jerry Heller, he owed me for all that studio time, and I told him I wasn't introducing him to anyone till I got my money. Easy was notorious for giving you crumbs, 15, 20 bucks on a debt, like you do a crackhead. He'd walk around like he was wearing an ankle monitor because he always kept his money in his sock. He would cry broke all the time because he never kept his money in his pockets. He always kept it in his sock. And if he wanted something, he'd go to his sock and pull it out. But if you asked him for your money, he'd pat his pockets and cry broke. I'm like, Easy, go to your damn sock and give me my goddamn money. All right, man, I'll give you your money. Hook me up with Jerry. Well, hold on, dude. You owe me the $500 anyway. What's in it for me to hook you up with Jerry? I'll give you an extra $250. Okay, that worked for me. So Easy paid his bill for $500 and gave me an extra $250 to hook him up with Jerry. So I called Jerry and told him this guy wanted to meet with him. It took me a couple of tries to get Jerry to meet with Easy. Look, man, this guy owes me some money. He wants to meet you. Take the meeting. I'd appreciate it. Jerry said, for you, I'll meet him. And that's what happened. Now, I gotta be honest. I didn't think Easy and Jerry would pan out at all. They were from two different worlds. When Jerry met Easy, he didn't think much of him. He came to me. Hey, man, what do you think about this thing? I don't know, dude. It's all right. But it's gonna be a headache because of so many times he says bitches and hoes. Besides that, the name is just crazy and it had cussing the whole nine yards. Jerry was very concerned about the whole cussing aspect of it. He tells the story like he thought Easy was a goddamn genius. Not quite true. He was used to dealing with guys like me, Rudy, and Egypt. We're all from the 80s, but we're all businessmen. We wore business casual clothes. We wore dress shoes every day. We wore slacks. You might catch me in a sport coat from time to time. Back then, Egypt wore a suit every damn day. We had briefcases. We knew how to conduct basic business. Eric walked around in Levi's, tennis shoes, and a white t-shirt. That was his thing. So it was a whole different mannerism. We're both from Compton, but we're from two different eras. Jerry seemed reluctant to deal with Easy at first. He damn sure wasn't sure about the music, and he was really confused about the name, Niggas With Attitudes. He expressed his concerns to me. Hey man, I'm a Jewish guy. These guys calling themselves Niggas With Attitudes. What do I do? How do I do this? I said, very carefully. That's why I didn't mess with it. I'm dealing with heavy hitters in the music industry. Larkin Arnold, Gerald Busby. These are my mentors. I can't tell Larkin Arnold, an NAACP member, hey man, I got this group called Niggas With Attitudes. You gonna sign them? And Gerald Busby, one of the most respected black men in the industry. I can't take him no group named Niggas With Attitudes. They throw me out the goddamn building. Truthfully speaking, Jerry had no idea what he had. Neither did the owner of Priority Records, Brian. But at the same token, Jerry was the best person for Easy to work with. I knew for a fact if I tried to sell them to Larkin Arnold or any other executives I knew in the industry, they would have my ass on a skewer barbecuing me at the next NAACP meeting. Because it was a non-black power machine that put it out there, Eric and NWA being out front, they were the focal point. So if it blew up in a negative way, they could deflect any negative feedback. And if it blew up in a positive way, everybody could reap the benefits. It all depends on the public reaction. As we all know, it started off rough. Eric had the ability to adapt to his character, Eazy-E, a young, crazy ex-dope dealer made good. Again, his size and natural ability to talk shit made him interesting. He was a modern-day James Dean. If you knew Eric like I did, it wasn't him. He was actually kind of quiet and a very laid-back guy.